Rakesh, thank you very much indeed for your welcome. And hello to everybody from England. I'm here in my study in the UK. I wish I was in India, but that's not possible. But I'm very impressed with the AirMeet platform. My first time using it. And I've been dipping into some of the conference sessions yesterday and today, and very much enjoyed listening to the other speakers. I've learned some new things. I've managed to interact a little bit through the Q&A function. I hope you will do the same with my presentation. It's a delight to be able to share some ideas with you. And thank you again for the invitation. So I'm just going to start sharing my screen, and hopefully that will go very smoothly. And here we go. Here are my slides. I hope everything is clear for you. So I'm going to be talking about black swans, and it's something I've spoken about for quite a long time. But one of your colleagues in the PMI Bangalore chapter challenged me when I offered this as a topic. And he said, are these real or are black swans just mythology? And he asked me to address the subject from that angle. I guess we've all heard of black swans. If you haven't, you will hear a lot about them in the next five or 10 minutes. But the question is, are they just something that people have made up, or is there something real and important for us to take care of and to be aware of and to deal with? So I hope to give you some interesting information, but also some practical guidelines that you can take away and use to make your projects more successful. I've been involved in risk management for more than 35 years, PMI, the Project Management Institute, in terms of developing our approach to risk management in projects, but also more widely, strategically, with governments and charities and so on. And I believe that risk management is the most important thing we can do, because our ability to manage risk directly determines how likely we are to succeed or to fail. If we manage risk effectively, we give ourselves the best chance possible of succeeding. And one of the things we need to be able to address in projects, in business, in life, are these things called black swans. So let's get straight into the subject. Please put your questions in the Q&A panel. I'll speak for about 30 minutes, maybe 35, and then we'll address your questions afterwards. So there are lots of mythological animals and beasts that people are aware of. Here are two of my favorites. The unicorn, a beautiful magical horse with a horn, very rare to see, but they bring you a very good fortune if you were to meet one. Or a dragon, perhaps not such good fortune if you meet one of these, very fierce and to be feared. And of course, the problem is that both unicorns and dragons, the good and the bad, are both mythical beasts. They don't really exist. They're the stuff of fairy stories and children's tales. And what about these things called black swans? Are black swans real, or are they a mythology? There is a natural story behind why we talk about black swans, which goes back 2,000 years, nearly 2,000 years. The first mention of black swans are in the poetry of a Roman poet called Juvenal. And here is his quote in Latin. He says, "This is something which is so rare, it's much like something like a black swan." What he meant by that was, this thing I'm talking about is, it's like a black swan, it's impossible. In England, in English, we have a phrase, we talk about something being as rare as hen's teeth. Of course, chickens, hens don't have teeth. So when we say it's as rare as hen's teeth, we mean it's impossible. And this is what Juvenal meant. It's the first mention in literature of a black swan. And the reason he said that is because when he was writing in the second century, so 1800 years ago, it was a known fact that all swans are white. Big birds, they live on water, they have big wings, long necks, and they're white. And everybody knows that as a fact. It's impossible for a swan to be any other color than white. If it's not white, it's not a swan. And we were convinced that this was a fact until in 1697, the Dutch explorer Willem de Vlaminghe discovered Australia, was exploring Australia, and found lots of interesting birds and animals in Australia that were not found anywhere else. Strange things like kangaroos and koala bears, the duck-billed platypus, very odd things. And a big black bird that lives on water, that has big wings and a long neck. It looks just like a swan, but it can't be a swan because it's black. And so he gave it a different name, a different genus, a different family. He called it a Chenopus. in Latin, because it couldn't possibly be a swan because it was black. And then examples were brought back to the West, to the Natural History Museum in London. People started to find out a bit more about them and discovered that, in fact, they are identical to white swans, just the colour of the feathers is different. And so black swans, we discovered, where previously we thought they were impossible, actually exist in reality. Now, this term black swans has been used in the world of risk management since 2007, when a writer called Nicholas Nassim Taleb wrote this book here, The Black Swan, which has become very, very familiar, very well known. The subtitle is The Impact of the Highly Improbable. And Taleb defined events with three particular characteristics as what he called a black swan. The three tests for a black swan are that it's an event which was completely inconceivable and unpredictable until it happened. Something that you couldn't possibly imagine, something you had no idea was even a possibility, and then it happened. And then when it did happen, it was very big. It had an extreme impact. And after it had happened, when we looked back, we thought, do you know what? We should have seen that coming. That's obvious, but it's only obvious after it's happened. So something which you couldn't imagine, but when it happens, it's very big. And afterwards, we look back and say, actually, that should have been obvious to us. Black swans have other names. We know them as unknowable unknowns. You've probably heard people speak of known unknowns and unknown unknowns. These are not just unknown unknowns, but they are unknowable. Things that we could not ever know, we couldn't imagine, because it's outside of our frame of reference, outside of our worldview, literally inconceivable. We also call these, the smart word is ontological uncertainty. It's to do with our worldview, with our way of perceiving things, or emergent risk, things which appear out of the blue, which we have no concept of until it happens. And in his book, Taleb gives lots of examples. This is perhaps the easiest one to understand. Taleb's turkey. He says, imagine you are a turkey living on a turkey farm. And when you're first born and you start to live on the turkey farm, things seem to be going very well. And people come and feed you and water you and look after you and make sure that you're healthy. And everything continues really, really well. And you get more and more healthy and bigger and fatter for about 3 months. And then after about 3 months, something tragic happens, something completely inconceivable, which is not in line with your previous experience. You actually get taken to the butchers. And the thing that is the big surprise is when we get to, in America, Thanksgiving, in other countries, Christmas, where turkeys are eaten as part of the celebration. And the poor old turkey had 3 months of delightful existence being looked after, where every day was better than the day before. He couldn't imagine the end that was waiting for him because of his previous experience until it happened. And so Taleb says that the turkey's life, the turkey's very short life with a good life and then a very sharp ending, is an example of a black swan. Well, are these things real? Niels Bohr was a Danish physicist. He said prediction is always difficult, especially about the future. And there are at least six characteristics of the future which make it difficult for us to predict. The first is that the future is dynamic. It's not static. It's changing all the time. The future is ambiguous. There are things about the future that we can't understand, which seem unclear and cloudy and strange to us, and we can't quite understand or perceive them. The future is non-linear. It's not possible to take the events of the past and just draw a straight line to predict what would happen in the future. There are disconnects. There are breaks between the past and the future. The future is glocal, a strange word made up of a combination of global and local, where things that happen on the global scale have big impacts locally, but also things that happen locally have an effect globally. And so we have this kind of interconnectedness in the future, which is very hard to predict how that will turn out. The future is emergent, where things come at us from left field, from out of the blue, from things that we had never expected. And the future is relational, because we can't see the connections between the different elements of the future. And when something happens in one area, it can have an effect somewhere else completely unrelated, because we can't see the relations and the connections. So with all of these different elements, it's very hard to predict the future. And perhaps that's why we have these things that we call black swans. Inconceivable until they happen, extreme impact when they do happen, and then appearing obvious after the event. So here's my challenge. I was challenged with the question, are they real? If things are unknowable, how can we know them? How can there ever be such a thing as a black swan if it's literally unknowable? Are black swans things that we use to scare people into perhaps doing what we want, into paying for expensive consultants like me to come and advise you about something that would never happen? Are black swans excuses where we say, do you know what, my project went wrong, but nobody could have foreseen that. It was a black swan. The black swan came and ruined my project. Is it a waste of time even to think about them? Because unknowable must surely mean unmanageable. If you can't know what it is, how can you do anything about it? And we'll come back to that last question in a little while. It's a really important question. Well, I believe that black swans are real, and there are many examples of black swans in our recent history. Let me give you some examples that I hope you will recognize. Some of them very obvious, some of them not so obvious. Let me go back nearly 40 years to the birth of the internet. Who could ever have foreseen the possibility of connecting virtually everybody in the world electronically through a common framework of a network of connections? Completely inconceivable, huge impact. It's changed the world. And now we look back and we see how things were developing in the world of computing and communications. And it's obvious that something like that would have emerged at some point. Once we had the internet, we had the arrival of social media, Google and Facebook and Twitter and all the other things that we have and lots of other similar platforms. These are the original logos. I know they've changed slightly now. Completely changed the world. Nobody could have foreseen the ability to communicate in these ways and the effect that it would have had on society and on individual relationships. How about the global financial crisis, 2007, 2008, which really changed everything? The migrant crisis in Europe, when there were mass movements of people from the Middle East, hundreds of thousands of people coming out of areas of conflict and looking for new homes in the West, many of them dying on the way. What about Brexit? If I could mention that very local black swan to us, nobody really expected that the UK would leave the European Union. Even the half of the country that voted for it never really thought it would happen. And now it has happened. Completely unexpected, inconceivable, had a big impact. And now we look back, perhaps the signs were there all along. Let me come to something perhaps a little bit more familiar, something a little bit more personal and real for us right now. What happened at the end of 2019 and the beginning of 2020 was the arrival of the coronavirus, the novel coronavirus, which leads to COVID-19. Was that a black swan? Well, probably not, because actually it was not unknowable that there would be a pandemic of a respiratory virus, a respiratory coronavirus. We've actually had one of these 100 years ago in 1918, known as Spanish flu, which killed 5 million people, which had a massive effect throughout Europe and other countries. So it's not unpredictable. We've had many papers, many studies, many people talking about the possibility of another coronavirus pandemic. We had SARS, we had MERS, we had avian flu. We had in the UK, we have a national risk register for the country. The number one risk in the first issue of the UK National Risk Register, the number one top risk was a respiratory virus pandemic. Even as recently as September 2019, we were simulating in the UK, we ran simulations of what would happen if there was a respiratory coronavirus pandemic. And 5 months later, it happened. The problem was that our simulations weren't very realistic. They downplayed everything. And then we recommended seven real actions, which nobody listened to and were never acted on. The World Health Organization has been talking about there being a coronavirus pandemic for a long time. So this is absolutely not a black swan. COVID-19 and the coronavirus, not a black swan, because it was predictable. It was not unknowable. We actually knew about it. It's just that we didn't take any the right level of preparatory action. But out of the coronavirus pandemic in early 2020, there has been a black swan. I was with my wife in February 2020 in South Africa, just when cases of COVID started to emerge in China, and then in Iran, and then in Italy. China locked down in Wuhan. We began to see similar actions in other countries. And I turned to my wife in February 2020 and I said, it's fine for China to impose a lockdown on their people. Their people will be compliant and they'll go along with that. That could never happen in Italy. It could never happen in Europe. It could certainly never happen in the UK that we would have a national lockdown where people were unable to leave their homes, where people couldn't go to work, where people couldn't travel to see their friends, people couldn't visit their sick relatives in hospital. That could never happen. Inconceivable. And then it happened. So the lockdown that came out of the coronavirus pandemic is a black swan, something we could never have imagined. And other things that have followed on, the death of international travel. My business is international. I've worked in 60 different countries on every continent except the Antarctic. I've made several visits to India in the past and many other countries. I love to travel. Not possible. Since March 2020, my passport is very dusty. It hasn't been used for so long. What about these huge piles of debt that governments have piled up in dealing with the effects of the pandemic, with paying people's salaries, with investing in vaccine development, investing in hospitals and so on, in ICUs? These are huge and unforeseen impacts that came out of the coronavirus pandemic. And they've had impacts which are massive. And looking back, we could perhaps have foreseen them. What about the seizing up of the global supply chain? Nobody foresaw that in quite the same way. Or how about this, the new variants? We've already had Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta. We're up to Omicron. Who knows where, how many more variants we're going to get before we get to the end of the Greek alphabet and we have to start on some other alphabet, Sanskrit maybe. Who knows? All these things are real black swans that have come out of the coronavirus pandemic. So I think these things really do exist. And if we look to the future, well, who knows? Because these things are inconceivable, we can't say what the next black swan is going to be. But I think we can say for sure they are real. These are not mythological beasts like the unicorn or the dragon. These are things which really exist, which are unknown until they arrive, which have massive impacts. And when we look back, we say, you know what, we should have seen that coming. So if they're real, and if they're big, and if they've happened in the past, and they're sure to happen in the future, but we're not quite sure what they are, can we do anything about them? The first thing to remember is that not all black swans are bad. You think about the internet, you think about maybe social media and some of these other things have actually had some bad impacts, but some good impacts. Some of the things which are completely unexpected, which arrived inconceivable until they happened and which have huge impacts. And we look back and say, yeah, that's obvious. Some of those things are actually good and helpful. Some of the black swans we have to prepare to protect ourselves from, and some of them we have to prepare to embrace if they arrive. So do remember that not all black swans are bad, just like risks. Not all risks are bad either. So what can we do about managing black swans if they truly are unknowable unknowns? We don't know what they are and we can't know what they are. Does that make them unmanageable? Well, I think the answer is maybe. We might not know what the actual black swans themselves are going to be, but black swans arise from a set of conditions which we can actually predict and know. And they have effects on us which we could recognize as real vulnerabilities in advance and do something about. So the two sort of sides that sit either side of a black swan, the things that give rise to a black swan and the effects of a black swan if one actually occurs, those are things that perhaps we could think about, we could identify, and maybe we could do something about in advance. So if we think about global causes are the things that give rise to black swans. We don't know what the black swan itself will be, but we might see the sorts of conditions that would give rise to a black swan. Where are we vulnerable? Where do our vulnerabilities sit, which give rise to the sorts of uncertainties that could hit us really hard, like a black swan? Is it possible to scan the environment to see where these vulnerabilities are, to spot them coming, and to see if we can identify early warning indicators or triggers of a black swan on its way? Risk management is like a forward-looking radar. It scans the future. It says, what's out there coming in my direction? Is there something way off out there which looks big and bad, which I need to protect myself from? Is there something way off over there which looks really good, which I need to steer towards? And with the risk management forward-looking radar that scans the future, we can also look for global causes that might give rise to black swans. I've got here on the screen two reports. One of them is from the International Risk Governance Council. It's actually here. It's first published in 2010, and it's called The Emergence of Risks Contributing Factors. And in this report, we don't have time to look into the detail, but it identifies 10 factors which give rise to black swans, which give rise to emergent risks. And if we see these things arising in our environment or getting worse or combining together, then we ought to think, could there be a black swan on the way? The World Economic Forum every year publishes something called the Global Risks Report. This is the cover of the 2021 report, which identifies major risks which have occurred in the last period, looks at interactions between them, looks forward to see what new risks might be coming, where they interact, to give new uncertainties that we hadn't previously been aware of. These two reports, and the Global Risks Report, is issued every 12 months, and it's freely available on the World Economic Forum website just to download as a PDF. The IRGC report is also freely available on their website. These resources are available to us to enable us to see the sorts of things that would give rise to black swans and enable us to look out for them, to be aware not of the swan itself, because it's inconceivable, but of its causes. And when we see those causes combining and arising, then we know that maybe we should be ready for something that we haven't yet seen coming. And if we can identify global causes, what can we do about handling local effects? Are there things we can do if a black swan were to arise to protect ourselves in advance against its effects? Let me suggest to you two key response strategies that will help us to protect ourselves in advance from something that we haven't seen coming. The first is flexibility. This little picture just on the right, if you do yoga, you might find this this position challenging. There's one person here. If you count the arms and legs, you'll see it really is just one person being extremely flexible, being able to bend their limbs into a very strange shape without breaking anything. Bending without breaking is a characteristic of flexibility, being able to flex and change, to adapt ourselves to the circumstances that we find ourselves in, like a chameleon. The proverb or the saying, I heard somebody mention this yesterday, the bamboo that bends is stronger than the oak that resists. Are we flexible enough when something arises that we hadn't foreseen to flex and to bend without breaking, so that we can, when the stress goes, we can bounce back? A second key response strategy is resilience. We had talks about resilience yesterday as well. Something which is really important, the capacity to keep going in the face of challenge, to maintain our purpose and integrity. If something comes which crushes us, and when that thing goes, we bounce back into our original shape. I have this phrase, Coco, we need to keep on keeping on, just going and going. It's a marathon, and we need to be prepared for that. Or a rather strange phrase, bounce back ability, which you might like to use. So these two things, flexibility and resilience, if we can build those into our people, our projects, our businesses, our society, our nations, then we can be ready, if a black swan arrives, to flex with it and to remain resilient in the face of its effects. So there are things that we can do for black swans to prepare for them if we monitor their global causes, if we see those things coming together, be ready. And if we think about where our vulnerabilities are and protect ourselves in advance by building in flexibility and resilience into our projects, our people, our businesses, then we can get ready to manage a black swan, even if we don't know what it is. So how do we build flexibility and resilience? I'd like to suggest four areas where we can do this. It starts with people, it starts with you, and it starts with me. Personal flexibility and personal resilience is the heart of being able to be flexible and resilient in our projects and our businesses, and even in wider society. We need to have flexible and resilient people, individuals, which comes from our character, which comes from our ability to practice emotional literacy or emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence has essentially the steps in it are, first of all, to be aware. What is going on inside me? Why do I feel like I feel? What are the causes of my particular internal environment? Once I'm aware of it, to be able to self-modify or self-moderate so that I can change the way I feel about things, to make intentional choices to change the way that I feel or the way that I respond, and to develop that resilience inside me by choosing something different. It's a big topic. We don't have time to develop it more just here, but it is really important that we think about personal resilience. Projects can be resilient if we have clear objectives, so we know where we're aiming, and appropriate levels of contingency and management reserve, flexible processes where we can change the process if we need to without changing direction, without affecting our ability to achieve our objectives, and of course, strong change management processes and risk management, I guess. I probably should say that. What about business level resilience? It's important with a business to have a shared culture, to know who we are, to understand what our ethics and values are, what our cultural norms are, to know how we make decisions, to know what's important, what we will do and what we won't do, to have a clear risk appetite so we understand how much risk is too much risk. These things will make us flexible and resilient in the face of the challenge of a black swan. To have robust processes that don't fall apart as soon as something changes or something is not as we expected it, and grounded values, which are not just statements on the wall in our mission statement, but which really matter in the way that we make decisions, in the way that we run our business, in the way that we value and remunerate our people, in the way that we handle our suppliers and our customers, to have real values that make a difference on the ground. This will make us flexible when things change. We know who we are and how we're acting and why we're acting. And it makes us resilient because we understand what really matters in our business. And finally, society. It is possible to have a flexible and resilient society. These principles have a much wider application than just me and my project or my project and my business. And rather like individuals or businesses, society needs to have a strong identity with shared values. What does it mean to be British? What does it mean to be Indian? How do we live in accordance with our values? Are they shared across the whole society? Do we have internal coherence of our values across all levels of society? So we understand who we are, how we live, why we live this way, and what matters and what we're going to do about it. So if we have these things in our societies, we can change with changing circumstances without losing our identity. We can be resilient in the face of the challenge of a black swan. If you wanted one word to summarize all of these different aspects at the personal, the project, the business, or the societal level, it might be this word, the word agility. And I need to say in the PMI context, I don't mean agile project management or adaptive project management. I don't mean that kind of agility. I don't really even mean organizational agility. I mean the agility which is the ability to flex with change and remain resilient in the face of challenge. And that might be a good keyword. There's a saying I love, if we can't control the volatile tides of change, we can at least learn to build better boats. I did see a picture in somebody else's presentation yesterday. He said, if we can't control the waves, we can learn to surf. Very much the same idea. And I very much liked that version of this idea. So the question is, the world will change. The tides are changing. The winds are blowing. The tide is coming up. What are we going to do? Are we going to try and swim against it? Or are we going to build better boats to help us to survive? So why does this matter? Why would I choose to talk to you about black swans, some strange birds that we thought were impossible until we discovered them, some strange kind of risk that is inconceivable until it happens with a big impact and obvious in hindsight? Why do we bother talking about these things? Why don't we just talk about ordinary project management or ordinary risk management or ordinary business? It matters because black swans are not a myth. Because black swans are not like unicorns or dragons, some kind of fake thing that people have made up for stories for children or for fantasy. Black swans are real. There really are major uncertainties on the way which we can't conceive of yet. And when they happen, they're going to be big. And when they happen, we're going to look at them and say, why didn't we prepare for this? Black swans are coming and they're invisible until they arrive. And when they do arrive, their effects will be huge and unpredictable because we hadn't seen them coming. But the good news is, in this world of black swans, that we can be ready for them. But more than just saying we can be ready for them by being aware of their causes and protecting ourselves in terms of flexibility and resilience. Not just we can be ready, we must be ready. If we want to give ourselves our best possible chance of succeeding in our personal objectives, in our project objectives, with our business goals, or even in our society, being a cohesive and healthy society, if we want to be like this, we have to be able to do better in handling the unknowable uncertainties that are definitely on their way. And it is possible for us to do something about it. Black swans are real, black swans are coming, but we can do something about it. So I'll stop there. I hope you found that useful and interesting. If we have any questions, I'm going to hand back to the moderator and handle your questions through them. My contact details are here, also available, of course, on the internet. And I've made these slides available in PDF format so that you can look at them again at your leisure and try and think through some of the issues involved. But I hope you found it interesting. More than anything else, I hope you found it useful so that you can be prepared for the black swans that are coming your way right now. Thank you very much.